So it's starting to get a little quiet, so I thought we'd, and at most everybody's back in from the buffet here, so I thought we'd get started. My name's Lawrence Rose, and I'm Dean of the College of Business and Public Administration. And I'm really pleased to have a chance to welcome you all here today, and to our beautiful campus, and certainly one of the highlights of that campus is our San Manuel Student Center, and you're certainly right in the middle of that. It's our third annual Prosperity Conference and Inland Prosperity Conference, and I think it's the best yet. And I'm hoping that you're getting quite a bit out of it. So do you think, is that right? Okay. And I'm sure by the time at the end of the day, we'll give you a few more tools to achieve those dreams that you have. I also want to thank the sponsors, Bank of America and Pacific Western Bank, as well as all of our vendors. I hope you've had a chance, so thank you. I'll eventually learn where to pause, and you'll teach me that by the time I'm done here, I'm sure. But I also hope that you get a chance to see the vendors on the side. I've kind of walked through briefly, and there's quite a, again, additional tools, different resources that we're really pleased that they've joined us to in this effort. The Inland Empire, as everybody's certainly aware, was really devastated by the Great Recession, even more so than most of the rest of the country. For many of you, you're going to be playing the role of getting us back on the road to recovery and continuing that road. I'm sure the time spending today will add to those your effectiveness in that effort and your success. I'm also very, very proud of the role the College of Business and Public Administration and all of our centers play in serving and increasing the quality of life in the Inland Empire. The Inland Empire Center for Entrepreneurship, the Women's Business Center, both of them sponsoring today, our Cybersecurity Center, our Global Management Center, where students get a chance to experience study overseas, our Leonard Transportation Center, and our Institute of Academic Research are all giving life to our mission, which is to make a difference in our community. And I'm hoping this is another good example, and you'll walk away with this thinking that maybe we've got something going that's pretty special at this university and certainly this college. Another example, and one that I have a little bit of personal interest in, is our VITA program, where we actually have students going out as we're here today and speaking today into the community, helping low-income, elderly, other people that just are not in a position to create and fill out tax returns for themselves. We go out in the community, and we're in downtown San Bernardino now at the library, helping them put those returns together for free. And bringing, we do about 2,000 of these a year. My wife's actually there, that's why I'm kind of, I have the interest help volunteering to help with that. And about 1.5 million back into the community in people's hands that probably wouldn't have had it without that help. It makes a difference, again, both to our students and our community. I'm also especially happy to have Janice Howroyd here at our conference. Thank you, Janice, for coming. I know how busy you are. I know that you've had to go back and forth. You're going back to another really important meeting after this. So thank you for making the time available to us. And I'm sure you'll all really enjoy what she has to say and take something really special away from today's talk. Now, our president, Tomas Morales, will introduce Janice in just a moment. Professor Morales is our fourth president. He has previously served at CSU Pomona as provost and VP of Academic Affairs, and he served as president of the College of Staten Island the City of University of New York, among many, many other positions that he's had. So you can see we ended up here with somebody very special as our president that's very, very experienced. Thank you, President Morales, for joining us today, and why don't you come up and introduce Janice.
Good afternoon. I also want to welcome all of you to the Inland Prosperity Conference. I want to thank the sponsors as well. I am particularly proud. I mean, the best part of my job is to work with our students and our faculty and our staff. Our students are just incredible. They're amazing. Learning does take place both in and out of the classroom, and this is an example of learning that's taking place on a Saturday afternoon. You all are here, and it's so important. I am particularly proud of our Entrepreneurial Center and our Inland Empire Women's Business Center and our Coachella Valley Women's Business Center. It's really an incredible organization that helped women develop their natural entrepreneurial instincts, and it's just an incredible opportunity for all of you to participate in this conference. It is indeed my honor to welcome to Cal State San Bernardino one of the great leaders of American business, Janice Bryant Howroyd. Ms. Howroyd is the chairman and CEO of Act One Group, a global leader in the human resources industry that specializes in partnering with firms looking to optimize human resource talent management. She is the embodiment of the importance of combining technology, education, and entrepreneurship with service. A strong advocate for innovation, she believes that technology is our business geography. As a sought-after speaker and lecturer, she shares her unique understanding of the challenges faced by workers and business owners throughout the globe. She offers practical as well as motivating solutions in her speeches, both in the U.S. and abroad. In 2009, Janice added yet another title to her already long list by becoming a published author. Her book, The Art of Work, How to Make Work Work for You, was written out of her passion for mentoring and helping others. And I will share with you that the very first time I met Janice, over lunch, and her passion about giving back, her passion about working with young people, with mentoring, it just came through and through. It was just so high energy and really wonderful to hear such an accomplished business leader be willing to give back in such a profound way. Among her many awards she has earned include the 2013 Vanguard Business Excellence and Achievement. Ms. Howroyd was also presented with the Black Business Association Lifetime Achievement Award, and in 2012, the Black Enterprise Business of the Year Award. She became a distinguished member of the National Society of Collegiate Scholars and received the Thurgood Marshall College Fund Entrepreneur of the Year Award. Janice currently serves on several boards, the Los Angeles Economic Development Corporation, North Carolina A&T State University Board of Trustees, International Trade Advisory Commission, and the Harvard University's Women's Leadership Board at the Kennedy School of Government. Among others, Janice is one busy and very highly accomplished working wife and mother. We are proud that Ms. Howroyd has taken the time from her busy schedule to be with us today to share her story and keys to success. It is so important to have entrepreneurs such as Janice to inspire and serve as a role model to our students, early stage and aspiring women entrepreneurs in this region. To learn more about her amazing life, let me direct your attention to the screen to really give a sense of what this wonderful woman is all about.
She's the founder of a corporate empire worth over $3 billion.
One is one of the largest staffing companies in the United States.
She's taken on the corporate world. Now, Janice Bryant Howroyd is ready to share her secrets for success.
I'm from a small town, Howroyd, North Carolina. There are 11 children in our family. Our mom and dad ran the family like a business. Dad was the president and mom was the COO. And I think a lot of what I learned about life and about business, I learned from how my home operated. Don't look around you to see what your opportunities are. Look inside yourself for them. We really grew up with that. For me, the moment was defining what I would do. And that occurred in Los Angeles.
In 1970, Janice parlayed $1,500 and a single phone line.
Our first office was actually the front of a rug shop.
Into a global staffing and technology empire worth over $1 billion.
My first big customer is still one of my best customers. Mama was right. If you treat them right, they stay with you.
Named one of Essence Magazine's 50 most inspiring African Americans and Ebony's 100 most influential Black Americans. A committed volunteer and mentor who's helped thousands realize their own dreams.
In order for mentoring to be effective, it also has to be an equal investment. Mm-hmm. Let's flip over and now let's start to see what you bring to the relationship.
She's already a sought-after motivational speaker.
I want you to applaud yourselves right now. Let's do it. Come on.
Talk show guest.
We have to think of ourselves as entrepreneurs.
And an expert on success.
I've got a lot of years, 30 years of experience building a business successfully. Those are experiences that people need to hear about, need to know about, and most importantly, they can learn from them. Never once have I changed anybody's life. What I do believe I've done is encouraged, inspired, and shown people how to change their own lives. I will not participate with the naysayers who say it's over for America or it's over for the American worker. What I say is, look at what we've really got working for us and put that to work.
Janice is ready to help America find success and balance in their own lives.
I just can't wait to help people to understand what my journey is like and more importantly, what their journey can be like.
Thought it. Oh, sit down, honey. Sit down. Don't stand up, lift it up, right? Who would have thought it? What am I talking about? Who would have thought that the little girl I was over 60 years ago in Tarboro, North Carolina, would be standing here today on a stage talking to the business leaders who will bring this economy forward. Who would have thought that? You see, I've learned over my journey, my personal and my professional journey, that You have to believe it into being. And I've had the opportunity to shake hands with folks this morning. She's going over there. Yeah, yeah. I've had the opportunity to shake hands with folks this morning, and it's very unnatural for me to be on a stage because I like to get out and walk around with people. But Kim Alexander asked me to keep myself on this stage today, so I will do that. And I don't know if you know Kim Alexander, but you know I'm old school, so you have to give props to the folks who get you here. Actually, Kim Alexander insisted I be here today. And I thought I was doing Kim the favor. I sat at the table and we shared that communication. I thought that I was doing Kim the favor to interrupt my travel to be here. Truly, truly there are no accidents in God, because the favor has been given to me to be here. Now, I work in human resources. That's the core of what we do. Everything I do in business has a point that it touches the ability to find talent for work in the world. And I started out in a rug shop, but we're now doing that in over 16 countries. And don't applaud that. Here's what you need to be applauding. We're doing that as a company with people who truly care about the workers. And these folks don't get to us before they come through universities and schools like this. They don't get to us unless they come through that. But no matter whether your journey is through a university and a fine university like Cal State University at San Bernardino, or whether you're coming out of a high school, or whether you're coming out of some East Coast university, there are some things that are very instrumental to how you succeed beyond the education, the formal education. And that's what Kim asked me to share with you today. So I'm so honored to do that. And I'm so grateful to Dr. Morales, not for just the brilliant introduction he gave of me. I mean, I was like, wow, she's awesome. but also because the minute I met him, I met a friend. And for someone like me, who, let's be honest, I told you I grew up in Tarboro, North Carolina, right, over 60 years ago. You can get a little jaded traveling around the world. For someone like me to meet someone and meet them as a friend, through a friend, what a blessing, huh? And that he has the professional, the academic, the work of a genius, and he meets you as a friend, so gently and so friendly. That was awesome for me. So I knew I would be here today through those two folks. Why I'm here is, again, to talk about seven keys to success, those that I have discovered. Let me tell you up front, there are many keys to your success, and some of them you will discover, but these keys I commit to you will get you through any door. Get your pencils ready. The first key I want to share with you is something that most folks who've ever heard me speak before already know. Now, by show of hands, how many people in this room are entrepreneurs? I'm looking, and I don't think you're being quite honest. No, not the folks who raised their hands about not being entrepreneurs, but the folks who didn't, because you are as well. You approach your life in an entrepreneurial manner no matter where you work. We're in a more competitive world today than ever. We are in a smaller world today than ever. You see, we're exploring places in the universe that we've never been before, and we're no longer talking about going out on space missions or discoveries. Now, when you hear conversation about people reaching beyond planet Earth, they're talking about setting up villages. Am I telling the truth? Yes. Keep me honest. And so we're living in a world today where everybody owns the space they occupy in a much more dynamic way. We live in a world where a cell phone can create $1 billion business overnight or be the vehicle to support creating a billion-dollar business overnight. We also live in a world where a cell phone can take down a government official. I'm not being political here. I'm speaking facts. You know, so it's really important for everybody who didn't raise their hand to remember to raise your hand the next time the question of your entrepreneurship is questioned, because truly you are your own brand in this world. And you are working as competitively as ever. The larger this world gets, the larger our universe, our understanding of the universe gets, the smaller the village that we actually compete in becomes. You follow me? Now, I'm standing in front of you, and some of you may be mathematicians, so you do the math, but I'm standing in front of you, born in 1952 in the Deep South. I had no concept of what the world looked like beyond my own immediate community. My sister Linda is here. I nearly said Zest, but she's got to be Linda today because she's got on a dress. but she'll tell you if I lie. I grew up in an environment where if I crossed Main Street, I was in trouble. That's how small my world was. Oh, don't get out a violin and cry for me, because I fly first class across the world today. And I do that because I understand what my seven keys for success are. You know, now I am Southern, so forgive me. I mean no disrespect to anyone, but I'm a Southern faith-driven woman. And so I'm going to make analogies throughout this conversation that are not lessons on faith or religion. They're just telling you where I'm coming from. Okay, and so I'm coming from a community where we were taught that God created the world in 7 days. I'm going to give you seven keys, and they work every one of those 7 days. Amen? Oh, no, I'm not there. I'm sorry. Right? The first key. You know this one, Brittany. Be where you say you're going to be, when you say you're going to be, how you say you're going to be. Now, I'm going to have to be honorable to that myself when I share this with you. Because honestly, I was about to break my first key and ask Gail Gaines to call Kim. Gail Gaines is my boss, y'all. So let him see who you are, Gail, because... And, you know, usually when I talk, after I leave, folks run up and they want to share a story with you or make a contact. And I always love that because that's just great. And they always ask for my card. And I think the joke's on them because Gail Gaines' card is the one they really need. But I was going to ask Gail, you know, Gail, can you please ask them to understand? I'm talking about Cal State University at San Bernardino. Can you ask them to please understand that I'm not going to be able to make it? I'm on the East Coast. I'm in Atlanta, and I'm going to have to be in D.C. in 3 days, and my mom and my sister are flying up, and I just can't. And Gail looked at me like I was crazy, right? And which was legitimate. I was crazy. And she said, Jan, Kim asked you to be there. You breaking your own rule. Be where you say you're going to be, when you say you're going to be there. And this is the important thing for those of you who are still students of your entrepreneurship, how you say you're going to be there. Now, y'all are lucky Kim kept me on this stage, because by now I'd be tapping somebody on the shoulder and asking, what do I mean when, well, I'm going to do it anyway. Gail, go tap somebody in the shoulder. Hurry up, because we have a finite amount of time that we're going to be in here. All right, ma'am, what's your name? Aaliyah, do you mind coming up here since Kim said I can't leave the stage? Come quickly, honey, come quickly. Oh, look, me too. Okay. What do I mean when I say be? You got where you're going to be, okay. When you're going to be. What I mean when I say be there, how you say you're going to be there.
That means wherever you, that means if you're on the East Coast, on the South Coast, on the West Coast, it doesn't matter if you're going to be there, no matter how you're going to be there, you explain where you are and how you're going to get there.
Well, since you came up here, I have to honor you for that, and that's your truth. I'm going to share you what my truth is. Be there how you say you're going to be there. Be ready. That's what it means. Be ready. You know, don't walk in. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Don't walk in unprepared. When I go into a meeting, I know not the morning of the stock, what it was valued at. I know the second, remember that cell phone I told you about? I know the second before I go into a meeting how that stock is trending. And I'm able to talk with people consistent to where their interest and their need and their perspective is. Most of you have been students at one point. And when you're honest with yourself, because we don't live in if, we live in when, right? Y'all did go to church, huh? when you were students, you showed up in the classroom sometimes not quite ready, and you patted yourself on the back. Yeah, y'all shaking your head, They don't have you on camera. They just got me. And you're patting yourself on the back because you rolled out of bed or out of wherever you were, and you showed up to class. And then you give yourself a pat on this shoulder because you got there on time. Boy, I made it on time. That doesn't cut it in today's world. It's not enough to show up where you say you're going to be, when you say you're going to be. You got to show up there how you need to be. You got to have read the material. You got to have done the research. You got to have taken care of yourself so that you are physically and mentally well to receive the knowledge being given you. And that was true when you were in classroom, and it's true in the boardroom as well. I'm talking with entrepreneurs, yes? And you can't hang up, my cough drop. You can't hang out all night and go to a meeting and be on point, because it's the little things you miss when you're trying to suffocate that yawn, or you're trying to pat, you've done it, huh? Or you're trying to pat, well, I'm talking about what I know because I've done it, right? You can miss a whole world in a moment. So that's the first key to success. B-E, where you say you're going to be, when you say you're going to be, and how you say you're going to be is the most important one of all. Let me get to the second key. The second key. Expect success. Kim asked me to share with you from my life, so I'm sharing with you from my life right now. When I grew up, as I grew up, in Tarboro, North Carolina, one of 11 kids. My sister, as I mentioned to you, is here today. She flew in from North Carolina yesterday. Now, I grew up, and I mentioned already to you as well, in a world where if I crossed Main Street in my community, I was in a foreign country. Y'all know what I mean by that? Okay. And I attended what you read about in your history books, a segregated school system. I was in the 11th grade, and integration came to our town. And our smart folks decided in our town that integration meant some black kids were going to go over to the white school. And listen, just to tell you how it was, we had nothing but black and white and two Jewish families in the community I grew up. How narrow is that? How narrow is that? Now, they decided the smart kids would go to the white school, and that would be our integration. And we decided to integrate because the federal government said we wouldn't get funding if we didn't. So that meant that I was getting up and I was walking across Main Street that you already know about to go to school and had to get back home quickly. I also grew up in a community where we had a library for up until my fourth grade, and then we didn't have a library anymore. And I loved libraries. Ask Gail, ask Brittany, ask Linda, ask him. In my home, I have books in every room. Okay, I just love books. Yeah, I got my Kindle, but I love books. Nothing replaces turning pages for me. And we didn't have a library. And so that created a dilemma for my family because they had to send my brothers to collect me before it got dark so I could safely come home. Are you getting a feeling for why I'm so passionate about education and about being prepared for your entrepreneurship? But I will tell you, whether or not you had my experience of growing up in a community where you had to travel into a foreign environment to even put your hands on a book, I didn't have a book that had all the pages in it until I bought one. Don't wow, because my daddy said, you are smart enough to figure out what's missing if you read the pages you have. Didn't daddy tell us that? Don't tell me you can't get it. Don't tell me you're going to flunk a test because you're missing some pages. You are smart enough to figure out what's not there if you read the pages you have. Entrepreneurs, I'm still doing that in my business life. I'm figuring out what's not there because I didn't get invited to that meeting or because I don't belong to that country club. Look, I'm talking to some Inland Empire folks, right? Y'all know what I'm talking about. But not being a member of the old boys network, forgive me, men, not being a member of the old boys network or not having an Ivy League degree means nothing. Half of those Ivy League degrees are taught by students anyway now. You get a better degree here. Do you get what I'm saying? Don't set your expectations based on your environment. Don't set your expectations based on your environment. Help me, somebody. Set your expectations based on your expectations. Expect success. And I've seen too many business people. I mentor some business women. I've seen too many business people who really don't think they're going to win. Who really think it's going to be a little harder for them than it is for somebody else. Who really thinks because they're not walking in there with red sole shoes or special buttons, they're not, and that has nothing to do with it. Because you got the same chin as anybody else. Hold it up. Be prepared and walk in and hold it up. And remember not to hold it up so high that you can't look somebody in the eye. I will tell you the difference. When people say, what was the difference between you and the company who didn't get it? And we just were awarded a huge opportunity. Huge opportunity. And I'm asked, why do you think you got it? I will tell you, there's a lot of stuff that supports why we won. But the discriminating factor is that I could look them in the eye. I could look them in the eye. You can't lie too long when you look somebody in the eye. All right? I better move on to that third key if you're gonna get all seven, though. Are y'all good on the second key to success? Here's the third key. And it appears some of you are holding that key in your hand today. I want to make sure you hold that key in your hand when you leave out of this room as well. And that key is listen. L-I-S-T-E-N. Listen. Now, that's a key that I have to keep going and get cut again. Okay? Y'all remember when they used to cut keys instead of hand you the little credit cards? And I lose a few of those credit cards as well when we're on travel, don't it, Gail? Gail always puts her name on my room because she knows she doesn't have to find me to get that key replaced. Listen, if I can remember anything from growing up, and by the way, I reference growing up so much because most of what I learned that mattered in business to me, I learned in my home. And then I academically prepared myself in a school. And if you married those two together, you got a pretty good formula working for you. But the thing that I remember most growing up is my mom or my daddy saying, Janice, shut up and listen. You know, and I'm one of those people who, you know, ooh, look at these flowers. These are so pretty. And they are, aren't they? Ooh, let me go. Zest, you saw some red, and they were yellow, and they were this, and they were that. Ooh, mama, and we went on the school trip, and we saw this, and we saw that, and we saw that. And, you know, and my mom would say, wait a minute, calm down, calm down. You can share. Listen, some of us get a little kernel of knowledge, and we're ready to tell the world about it, and we forget to keep listening. And some of the greatest teachers in the world will tell you, and I've been told by some of them, that the best skill they have is to listen to their students. It's then they know how to teach them what they need to impart. You can't keep teach if people don't learn, right? You're not teaching if they're not learning. Some schools think they are, but if they're not learning, you're not teaching. And the best way to connect that is to listen. And listening is a shared ingredient. Write that down. It's a shared ingredient. It doesn't work unless both parties are doing the listening. Remember those pages missing out of your book? Those pages in your book as entrepreneurs may be funding. Those pages missing out of your book may be network opportunities. Those pages missing out of your book may be your own personal skill sets to present your product or your service in the best way, and you know you can do it so well, but you just don't speak the language of the people who are buying. There are a lot of ways to miss pages out of your book. But if you listen well enough, if you listen out loud, you can still grow your business. You can still win the contract. You can still get the product mentioned. You can still build the brand. But you gotta listen. Now, major corporations and major brands listen all the time. They hire professional listeners. They hire people to go into the streets where our kids are walking around with their baggy pants. And they're walking around with a wide brim baseball cap instead of the circular brim baseball cap. They listen to what's happening in the streets and they put it together somewhere outside of the United States. And then they build it and they remarket it to the world at high profit. And you, some of you, spend your money on your kids to go in the store and buy it. What they were wearing 5 years ago that's been rebranded with somebody else's name on it, and you work hard and you buy it. These people are listening to what the streets are telling them and selling it back to the streets. If listening can work for them, can it work for you? Enough about listening. Where are we now? Which key? Four? Invest. You must invest in yourself, but here's the key to this one. You must also remember to invest in others. No entrepreneur should look toward growing a business today that is selfishly bred. Now, whether that's investing in your employees, whether that's investing in your community, whether that's investing back into the institutions that educated you, you must invest, and you don't wait until the day you get rich to do it. And if you don't have money to invest your time. And if you don't have time, invest your kids. You're laughing, but I'm telling you my truth. I just saw somebody today who came up to me. I'm looking for now. Raise your hand if you don't, if you want to be acknowledged for. Told me, stand on up. Told me, hey, look, I got pictures. I was trying to find them last night. Y'all don't do anything you don't want to be found for. She said, I got pictures, and it's of you and your son, and you were walking the red carpet in Beverly Hills, and I was going to bring it to you. And where is she? And she answered the question. And I'm like, he was this big. He was this big. You know? But my point is, I was investing my son in that event because it needed to be supported. So I'm not joking when I say invest your kids, because that's one of the best investments you'll ever make for them as well, is to invest them in community work, charitable work, good work. If you'll forgive me for saying it, God's work. You have to invest in yourself, but remember to invest in someone as well. I'll just give you a quick anecdote and move on to, I think, what is the fifth key. My mama, Miss Elretha Knight Bryant, Mrs. Elretha Knight Bryant, 11 kids, one mom, one dad. My mama got at us one time. Zest is laughing. You know what I'm going to say, don't you? My mama got at us one time. When I say got at us, that means she's chastising you. You know, when you leave North Carolina, you have to remember you're not in North Carolina. But when your mama get at you, that means she's chastising you. My mama got at us one time because we had stolen dessert out of the refrigerator. And didn't we? And she was the ringleader, not me. And my mama said, wait till your daddy comes home. Daddy was a disciplinarian. All mama had to do was cry, and you felt like you were just the scum of the earth. And daddy came home, and daddy got at us because we had stolen the dessert. But then he got us again because we didn't steal any for the other kids. And we were like, that's not fair. You already punished us. And he was like, you committed two crimes. You stole for yourself and you didn't look out for your sisters and brothers. I have taken that lesson through my life. Now, I'm not recommending you steal. What I am encouraging you, pleading with you, as you grow your businesses, don't just invest in yourself, invest in the folks around you. People talk about giving back. It's fine to give back. You should give back. Give as well. Give as you grow. Don't wait till you get there to give it back. Okay, which key are we on now? Okay, this key is educate. I'm going to be very quick about it because I'm speaking with some very smart people. You must consistently, continuously educate yourself. And some things you have to re-educate yourself to. Some things that were true yesterday are no longer true today. Things. Now, when you get above things, truth lives and truth is. We're not going into that realm. I'm talking about things like how to get a letter to Brittany. 50 years ago, you wrote a letter to Brittany and it was on paper. How do you get a letter to Brittany today? Do you hear all the answers? Email, text, can I get a tweet? You get what I'm saying? So you got to keep yourselves educated. You got to stay current. You got to stay relevant. You've got to stay invested in consistent education, learning consistently. Which key are we on now? Value, access. You know, North Carolinians have a problem with CC and SS. I'm talking about ASSESS. You've got to make sure that you do that regularly. You've got to step back and evaluate your values as you continue to move. I'm not talking about that personal set of core values. That has to be firm. That has to be rooted. Okay? That's alpha and omega for you. Okay? There's nothing before and nothing after that. Your value system. As a matter of fact, whenever I speak, I always tell people, no matter who you wish to be professionally, right? Have you heard me say that? Never compromise. Can I hear it again? Never compromise who you are personally to become who you wish to be professionally. Now that's where you need to applaud, okay? Never compromise who you are personally to become who you wish to be professionally. That's consistent. When I'm saying value assets, I'm talking about those things in your company. What did you value doing yesterday that needs to be tweaked and done differently today? IBM can tell you a lot about that. They used to sell typewriters. The Selectric 2 was my brand. I love that typewriter. Okay, it was the best thing ever invented, and I miss it a lot. I could cry for it. However, y'all are laughing, I'm telling you the truth. I'm just trying to talk quickly because I know we have a finite amount of time. But today, IBM will tell you that they are an infrastructure-driven company, and they're focusing on how to get corn out of the Corn Belt into China. You see what I'm saying? So they have to value assets in order to stay current and in order to thrive. And it don't hurt none that Apple came along, right? So that, you know, competition drives you to value assess, even if your own entrepreneurial spirit won't do it, is the point there. Are we at the seventh key? What do you think the seventh key is? Well, it is a key that I use a lot, because what have I built my business doing? Employment, right? Employ well. I'm not just talking about the people you hire and hiring the best people you can and then supporting them to become even better. Because in school, we learn good, better, what? Now, in my life, that's the one thing I don't accept from school. I accept good, better, best, better. Good, better, best, better. Keep getting better. And you keep getting better by employing well. And one of the best employments I've ever made in my business, and this is the most precious key I hold in my personal and professional life, and that is to employ a higher power every step of the way. I don't care who your higher power is. Now, I told you, I grew up in North Carolina a whole lot of years ago. You can guess who mine is, and I get there through Jesus. I don't care. I don't care whether you get there through Jesus. I don't care who you get there through. Get there. There's a song out there, get there when you can. You need to get there, because as entrepreneurs, as business people, and God forbid we do well in money with it, because some of the best entrepreneurs I know have not been the most financially profitable ones. If you want to know what I'm talking about, think in terms of Gandhi, Mother Teresa, Martin Luther King, all entrepreneurial spirits, right? Not financially wealthy. In order to know true success, you must employ great people. You must employ a higher power as well. Let's review them and I'm done. The first key. Second key. Third key. Y'all got a cheat sheet. Fourth key. Fifth key. Sixth key. Seventh key. If you believe, you will succeed, entrepreneurs. God bless you all. Thank you so much. What happens now? Okay. Sit down, sit down. Sit down. Kim said I can answer some questions. Sit down. God bless you. Sit down. Kim said I can ask some questions and answer some questions, and I don't know how it works, so who's facilitating? Oh, we've got lots of. Come up, come up. Come up quickly, because how much time do we have for questions, Kim? Okay. You have a mic? Borrow mine while you wait for that one.
Perfect.
I'm one of 11 kids, so I can yell.
So we can get through the rest of these?
Okay.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm from North Carolina originally as well, so I can relate to where you've come from.
All right.
And where you are now. Olivia, between Sanford and Fayetteville, North Carolina. Okay. Yes, but where you start from isn't where you end up.
Amen.
Living proof of that. Who or what inspired you to keep on going in life when you ran into adversity?
I'm from a family that doesn't allow you to forget where you came from, which you just finished talking about. I was flying overseas. Well, I've done that often and done this often, but this particular time, I was flying overseas after a really grueling period of work, and it was 4 o'clock in the morning. I had to get to the airport. I was feeling really bad for myself. All these people who were in my beautiful home would get to enjoy it, and I was like, I'm on the road 3 weeks out of the month, and I'm like, I'm not really getting to stay here. You know, you go through those periods when you want to start to have a pity party. And my sister calls it another word, a different kind of party. It's not pity, it rhymes with pity. And she owns a hair salon, and so, you know, that's the best psychiatry you ever get. And I call my sister Zess, Linda, I'm sorry. And we're dressed up today. And I was throwing it at her, and she asked me, she said, Jan Howroyd, I'm not, whenever she calls me by my first and last name, I'm in trouble. Jan Howroyd, I'm not going to listen to you this morning. And she's on the East Coast, so see, it's 7 o'clock for her. She's already had coffee. And she's like, I'm not going to listen to you this morning. She said, I could point to 3 or 4 different people before I get off my street who would love to have somewhere to go. And if I turn around the corner to Johnson Street, I can show you a man who would love to be able to even get up to go. He ain't been up. You know, your family keeps it real with you. And your family may not be the folks, you may not be as blessed as I am. Like my mother and father birthed me with 10 best friends. You may not have that, but you can create that family. You've got to stay core with people who know you from when you were in, what's that place you're from? Olivia, North Carolina. You got to stay grounded with the people who know you from where you're coming from, and they honestly know where you're coming from. Not do you get where I'm coming from. They honestly know where you're coming from. They keep you grounded, and they remind you of why you're doing it, and they remember when you need to, they remind you when you need to pause and stop doing it and get yourself together. Next question.
Love to talk. Thank you. Real quick, what is the best advice you've ever received?
The best advice I have ever received came from my family and my church, which is I can do all things through God who strengthens me. It's meant a lot to me over my journey because it ain't just about defaulting. I've heard people say faith is a crutch. Well, sometimes you're broken and you need a crutch to walk, okay? But a crutch can also be picked up in your hand and be a sword and be a weapon, okay? And so for me in business, as I do it, I go into rooms where I know people see the physical of what's walking in before they even know what's inside of me. And I have to make sure that I keep that strength that's given me equal to anybody in this room and only differentiated by the power with which I give it.
Wow, you have answered my question is, you know, that inner strength, you know, that inner strength when, you know that, you know what you know, but then you have those you doubt yourself sometimes, but then you have those haters at the same time, but you keep showing up because you know
what's inside of you. Thank the Lord for haters. Love the haters.
Okay. Okay.
Love the haters.
Okay.
Love them.
Okay.
The haters would tell me that this is too big.
Yeah.
The haters would tell me that this ain't real. Uh-huh. The haters would tell me, whatever they want to tell me, but I know who I am. My haters strengthen me.
Amen.
You don't know how strong you are. Listen, let me tell you something. Wow. You can never appreciate being on top unless you know what the bottom feels like. Wow. Love the haters. Love the haters.
Hi, Gwen Doth at Seventh Camp. First, thank you. Wow.
Thank yourself. You are here.
You just, man, you're awesome. I don't even have a question. I just want to say that what you were saying, I'm serious. I've been in business for a few years now.
Aww.
And I just needed to hear what you had to say. I'm so sorry.
I can tell you about somebody who can fix it.
Okay, no more crying. Mascara.
Hi, my name is Yusuf. I'm a student here. My question is, what is the most important things that you think students should know about the real world?
The most important thing students should know about the real world is that it is consistently being built. See, because your idea, you got to define real. Like people say, keeping it real. Usually when somebody tells you they're keeping it real, or let me give you an example of what I mean that's quicker to the point. How many of you have ever heard the term reality TV? Yeah. What's the root word in reality?
Real.
Now, how real do you think that stuff is? Okay, the real's gonna come from you. And here's the other thing for a student to know, okay? Your real may not be my real, okay? But when we are cooperative, we can really get along. You see what I'm saying? So you got to have it in you, and you got to know who you are, and you've got to know where you want to go. The result is always the truth. It doesn't matter what's there, what is there, what's in your way, what enables you. The result is going to always be your truth, and that's the touchstone that you use as you continue to grow. The best thing you can know is that your real is what matters. That's what's really going to matter in the world, okay? Because there are some people out there who can show you some stuff and make you think they're for you. And there are some people who you won't believe are for you who are really more for you than any. You got to know who you are, and you got to keep in touch with yourself so that you can continue to move and grow where you want to go.
Hi.
Hey.
You said most of what you learned about business started when you was a child in the home.
Yes.
Myself and a couple of my business partners, we teach a summer camp here at Cal State, and we teach entrepreneurship and technology to children. I was wondering, what's the most important entrepreneurial concept you learned as a child?
Well, you see, in my home, my father may have been the CEO, but my mother was the COO. Okay? And the best business concept I learned, here's something people don't believe. Now, think about it. And you know, thank God that we were, because I meet a lot of people who weren't born as blessed as we are. I met a lot of people, remember I sit on these boards at Harvard and stuff. I meet a lot of people who, you know, money has never been an obstacle for them. Yet, I know I was born richer than they will ever be. My mother and father loved each other. The day my father passed away, taking two of his employees on a fishing trip, I was home visiting, and I saw my mother and father. They would always get up early in the morning before we woke up, and that was their date time, and they did it every day they were in the house together alive, okay? He's the only man she ever knew, and they loved each other like teenagers that morning. I was actually uncomfortable. I was in the... I was in the den, and they were sitting at the table in the kitchen, and they were just cooing like 16-year-olds. It was really uncomfortable for me. And little did I know that was the last time my mother would see my father alive. And I watched them cooperate. Now listen to me. I remember when my daddy came home and celebrated that he got a raise to $80 a week. We were already a family of 11 kids, a mom and a dad, and whoever else dropped in for dinner. And yet we always had something to share with someone. We always had more than enough. You get what I'm saying? Now, Michelle Obama is teaching people to eat green and grow these gardens and stuff. We had a summer garden and a winter garden because we didn't eat if we didn't have them. We were green because we needed to be green. But we always had vegetables to give somebody else. Am I lying, Zess? You know? And so when I grew up in a home that knew how to make the most out of what it had, create enough to be in affluence, abundance. I saw this kid, was it last year, who got off of a crime because he said he had affluenza. Did y'all see that in the... You know, if you didn't Google it, affluenza, kid who got off of affluenza. He got off of a crime because he was too affluent, had no reality to life. I grew up in a family where my mother and father were cooperative in their leadership of an organization that we call the Bryant household. And we knew how to not just make ends meet, but make ends grow. You see what I'm saying? So I learned from my parents that, again, remember, this is a lady whose dad had told her, if you read the pages you got, you'll know what's in the ones you're missing. You know? So I learned from my family how really a business should operate. And I also learned from my family that everything is business. Remember I asked these folks who didn't raise their hand? Remember, you're an entrepreneur as well. You may be an entrepreneur in the company you pay the tax for, or you may be an entrepreneur in the company someone else pays the tax for. But always be about your own brand. And Gail looking at me like she's going to kill me if I don't get out of here in a minute. That's my boss, y'all. Yes, ma'am.
Hello, it's really nice to meet you. I was wondering if we could exchange contact information because I would like for you to mentor me.
Well, that is great. I'm going to tell you something about mentoring. You may have seen it in the video clip. Mentoring works both ways. Both parties have to be equally invested. I salute you for asking me to mentor you, and I also thank you for a teaching opportunity. Don't ever ask someone to mentor you unless you've done the homework to know what they would want out of that relationship as well. That said, my boss is right there with a business card. You can get the contact information you want, but you better be ready when you come to me.
I'm going to ask her to sign it. I need you to sign that for me.
I will do that.
Afterwards?
I will do that, ma'am. I sure will. I'm really rushing on a time frame that she's going to kill me. Let me sign it when we finish the questions. Okay.
We are so glad you're here.
I'm blessed to be here. I'm glad to.
I'm Barbara Babcock. I asked you this question about an hour ago, and maybe the same answer or a different answer. What is something that you thought was just a tragedy or a big mistake in your life, and it turned out to be a blessing?
It's the same answer I gave you, because I remember you asking me.
She does.
What's funny? I got my first $1 million contract, and before I went in, before I knew if we would get it, you know, I was, back in those days, I was always asking God. Just pray. And by the way, you know, I ain't trying to teach you anything to do different than you want to do, but Kim asked me to talk about my keys. One of the keys that's worked for me is I thank God. Yes. I don't walk around begging God no more. I'm not a bent down begging Christian kind of person anymore. And I know we all, you know, come from different places, and some people like that experience. That's great. We get there how you can. But I've learned to thank God, but back then I was begging, Lord, if you just let us win this contract, you know, I'll give the profit from it for, I don't know what's going on over here. Can y'all hear me? Yes. I'll give the profit from it the first year to scholarships to students. Well, God delivered, and we got the contract. But business started to get a little rough me a year, and I wanted to fall out of that commitment. And I thought that was an awful thing for me to have made a deal with God and break it. Right? So I kept my deal, but I really thought that was going to be tragic for me. But the truth is, it ended up being the best thing I could have ever done, because two of the people who we were able to place via that contract were excellent contacts for me, and one of them had a mother in HR, and they invited me to meet their mother, and that gained me another contract that was bigger than the one I had won.
Hello. What's the worst advice you have ever heard?
The worst advice, the worst that someone ever gave me?
Yes.
Keep doing what you're doing. You so fine, you got it, you know, don't listen to the hype. When people start to give you advice based on hype, you know, you got it, you don't need this, you don't need that, don't listen to that. Remember I told you, you've always got to be learning. You got to consistently educate yourself. The day you think you're the smartest person in the room is the day your value declines. Don't ever think you're the smartest person in the room. And I've had many people come up to me and, you know, advise me I shouldn't be here, shouldn't be there because I'm above that. I just last week, someone was asking me to join a board, and someone told me, oh, those ladies, they, you know, they're not of your caliber. You don't need to be joining that. You need, your brand is bigger than that. You need... That's not great advice. When people start to advise you that you're too good to be somewhere else, that's not good advice. And I've had that advice thrown at me many times over my career. But the truth is, you can't follow people's advice when they start to try to build it based on hype to you. Or what do they call it? Flattery? You know? Don't follow advice like that. I've been given that many times.
Go ahead. Did you?
And you never know when you're going to see your creator. The one that they tell you is too low down for you to reach down and help may be the one who's actually lifting you up.
Absolutely. Man.
Hi, I'm Merrick, and I just wanted to ask you one empowering question for the ladies here, and that is, when do you know that you've volunteered enough, you've given away your services enough, when do you know it's time to really create a legacy or that wealth for your business, and how do you turn that, you know, always volunteering and giving away your services, how do you know to turn that off?
I don't know the answer to that. I've not gotten there yet. I believe that here's one thing I will tell you when you speak specifically to ladies, although I think it's valuable information for men as well.
Absolutely.
You need to remember that you're not the only one investing in your business. Your family is investing in your business as well. Too many nights I've said prayers with my kids by phone. Too many days I've had to call my sister and create a sense of wellness and fulfillment for myself, a little bit of home. So I think the only way I can answer you is to say, let your family be a guidepost for you. When you start to believe that you're asking them to invest too much, then it's time to step back. You should not forget home. What do they say? A shoekeeper's kids are never shorn. You know, make sure that you're not depleting your family and the things and the people who help to support you in order to do it. That would be the best template I could use, because different people approach business differently. I've been told that I'm like an ever-ready bunny, and I go and go and go. Now, I don't get that. I feel like I'm on, you know, but I've been told I'm a high-energy person. So I use my family as a touchstone. Yeah, they're a barometer for me for when I need to step it back a little bit or give some time to, you know, be home. I have a husband who absolutely adores me. As a matter of fact, everybody over 18 in here. No, it's going to be clean, but it is 18-year-old and older information. Or what Zess is picking up her drink saying, maybe TMI. But just when I was getting ready to come here this morning, my husband had just, and my son had just gotten in from a trip to San Francisco. And so I was going to sneak through to get dressed, because I had to get up at 4 o'clock to get here this morning. So I was going to sneak in and get dressed, and he slept in his office, and my closet is around the corner from it. And I had just showered and dried off and put my lotion on. You know, ladies, how you let it dry in a little bit, you know, keep the ash down. And I was running around the corner to my closet, and I didn't have my towel on. Okay, and don't think about that. And I was running around, and I got dressed in the closet because I didn't want to turn all the other lights on, right, and disturb his rest, because he got in after midnight last night. And I came back out, and I had this dress on. And I thought he was asleep, and my husband is British. He turned that off. He don't want that on camera, huh? And my husband is British, and he said, "Ooh, lovey, you looked better going in than coming out." He said, "But I like your dress all the same. I think it's time for me to leave here and go back home to my husband."
Janice Bryant, Howroyd. She has given us a gift. I think you'll all agree that Janice has given us a gift that really has no value, has no monetary value. Her just incredible wisdom, her advice, her counsel is priceless. I do want to share with you that we have a very distinguished alumna, Cheryl R. Brown, who's the assemblywoman of the 47th Assembly District, and she couldn't be here today, but she wanted to give you this really certificate of recognition for coming to her alma mater. And we do have a small gift of appreciation. So what's going first?
Thank you.
And this can actually fit in there.
Okay.
You must have talked to Gail because I love flowers.
And thank you so much.
Thank you.
For being here.
Thank
now
you.
This is not going to be your last time.
Oh no, I'm
coming
home
here.
Now.
All
I'm
right.
Home
all
now.
Right. Let's do it. Okay. Thank you.
I'm home.
God bless you.
God bless you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much.